Therefore, laughing heartily lowers our blood pressure, it expands lungs and so more oxygen, it makes you feel relaxed. You know, our brain is a very selfish organ. 25% of the oxygen that we take in is consumed by the brain. And all the other whole body, all the other systems, 75%. This takes 1/4 of the oxygen. That's why when there is a lack of oxygen, I think after a few seconds or 2 minutes, we go into unconscious because our brain shuts all the other organs and only the brain is active. If the brain continuously doesn't get to for 4 minutes, I think, then the person can go into coma, right? Because the brain needs oxygen. And when we go into coma, it can become a coma or a full stop, it all depends. The coma becomes a full stop or a coma, that means we can come back to life. So our brain needs oxygen. So when you laugh really heartily, the lungs expand, more oxygen goes inside, our brain becomes fresh and active, and its functions can become more productive. Yes. And plenty of occasions to laugh. If only we are sensitive a bit more. Some are subtle, some are very obvious. Sometimes we find like this board. In case of an emergency in this building, please call such and such number, extension, and leave a message. Okay? Does this board make any sense? Right? Right. So we need not go and ask some people, no, make me laugh, no, tell some jokes, give some humor, or tickle me, I want to laugh. No. We have to be sensitive enough to pick up and create a chance to laugh. Sometimes we find board like this. This is a private sign, please do not read. And where do they put it there? Okay. Yeah. Wife is asking, why do you wear your specs only when I come in? Husband says, the doctor has ordered me to wear my specs whenever I get headed. Oh, it can be the other way also. Okay. Wife is asking, why are you home so early? My boss told me to go to hell. My wife died yesterday. I'm trying to cry, but tears are not coming out. What to do? No problem. Just imagine she came back. It can be the other way also. All right. So far, I've been supporting only women. Let me support men also sometimes. Okay, husband is asking, do you know the meaning of wife? W-I-F-E means without information, fighting every time. That's what the wife does. But the wife is more clever. She says, with idiot forever. Okay. So the sense of humor is very important, very essential in life. You know Mahatma Gandhi, our national father of India, and he's a great Mahatma, great spiritual man and great leader. He said, but for the sense of humor, I would have committed suicide long back, he said. And that is true, maybe in most of our cases also, but for the sense of humor. Now that humor really relaxes us, it brings us back to the track. In fact, after 2 months, I have to present a paper on sense of humor, philosophy of humor in India, in a conference. I'm just working on that. And one author says, humor is nature's way of bribing the brain. You know, brain has lots of stress and struggles, and the sense of humor is there to bribe the brain so that the brain forgets all that thing and comes back to life. If there's no sense of humor, that would be the end of our life. Okay, so that was the ninth one. And finally, my dear friends, cultivate a sense of spirituality. You know, spirituality is not the same as religion. Not a guarantee that all religions have it or all religious people have it. Spirituality is different from religion. Religion may help you to have acquired spirituality, but spirituality is different from religion because religion is confined to the sacred books or the places of worship or the rituals, the rites, etc. It's okay, we need, but all these things must help us to have a sense of spirituality. And there are people who are really spiritual, they may not need follow any religion as such. So today what we need perhaps more is spirituality, not just religion. The other day when I spoke about science and faith, Paul Davies, a great Nobel laureate scientist, physicist, says, science offers surer path to God than religion. Today, unfortunately, we find lots of violence and divisions, bloodshed and killing, murders in the name of religion, in the name of God. But all these people don't have spirituality. They may have many religions. Today, what we need is spirituality. This spirituality will help us to learn to let things go. It's a very, very spiritual notion. Learn to place things in a larger and truer perspective. Oftentimes we have narrower perspective in life, and we have imagined perspective in life, and we have false perspective in life, and that gives us lots of problems. a real sense of spirituality will enable us to keep things in a larger perspective and truer perspective. Psychological immune power, neither joy nor sorrow is going to be with us too long. You know, sometimes we think this thing should happen in my life, then I'll be the most happiest person. I must marry this man or that woman, then that is the real paradise for me. You marry him, marry her, 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, all your joy will go. Again, we'll be back to the square one. Similarly, I'll be thinking, this should not happen in my life. I really detest, I'm really frightened. If I think of that, my hands are shivering. That should never happen in my life. Okay, it might happen. You may be really suffering for 1 month, 2 months, 3 months. Then again, you'll be back to your normal life. So that is called psychological immune system, immune power. So nothing will keep us joyful forever. Nothing will keep us sorrowful forever. Realize that this too will pass away. And really that's a sense of spirituality. This too will pass away. Yeah. And when we speak about spirituality, we need to realize a spirituality which is developed when we are young, when we are at our youth. You know, the spirituality that comes only when we are old age, that's not a, need not be a genuine spirituality. Because the spirituality that we acquired when we are old, it is a result of our fears. Fears of many things. Fears of loneliness, fears of illness, fears of death, fears of hell. And that spirituality need not be the real spirituality. So the spirituality must be developed when we are young. Unfortunately, not many young people are here. But still you can communicate this to them. Because if you don't have the taste for prayer, taste for God, taste for spirituality when we are young, when we grow old, we may not think even that turning to God is an option. We may turn to drugs, we may turn to alcohol or sex, pleasure, things like that. Turning to God is an option that we will not even know if we don't have the experience of God, experience of spirituality when we are young. This is always I insist upon when I talk to youngsters and college students. And this meditation activity, observe total silence of the body, mind and spirit. You know, the silence is really killing. We are afraid of silence, but the silence is very, very essential. Silence is needed for growing in our knowledge, to grow in science. For instance, Isaac Newton, they say, the apple fell on his head, and he thought about it, why the apple should come down instead of going up. So he spent time in silence, and that was a very fruitful, productive silence, right? And so silence is very essential to grow in our knowledge, in our relationship, in our spirituality, and only when you are really silent, the truer self comes to the surface. And because we are afraid of silence, we see to that some noise or other will be always there. Either our television set is on or the neighbor's television set is on, and some noise. Meditation activity, today the science has proved how the meditation really improves the health of the brain. And mind can control the body. Yes, we'll just move to the next one. I want to show that clip for 5 minutes. Breathing and visualizing exercise, yes. The power of mind over body, you can take that clip. It is by the Dr. Lisa Rankin. You can take down this name. You can go to the YouTube also. We'll just play 1 or 2 minutes to find out what she's telling us. You know, there's something called placebo. Placebo is a medicine. Is given, it's only an apparent medicine. It's not real medicine. And yeah, you can play. And it may be just a distilled water, but if the person is really convinced of that, having a positive attitude towards it, that distilled water can cure the person. Opposite to placebo is nocebo, N-O-C-E-B-O. That is the other way. When my mind is controlled or mind is fixed on particular thing, my body will not heal. Are you able to get that clear?
Research. And what I discovered is that the scientific community, medical establishment, has been proving for over 50 years that the mind can heal the body. Mm-hmm. We call it the placebo effect. And we've been trying to outsmart it for decades. The placebo effect is a thorn in the side of the medical establishment. It's an inconvenient truth that gets in between trying to bring new treatments, new surgeries into the medical establishment. So it's a problem, supposedly. But I actually think this is really good news. The placebo effect is excellent news because it's concrete evidence that the body holds within it innate self-repair mechanisms that can make unthinkable things happen to the body. So if you find this surprising, if you have a hard time believing that the body can heal itself, you need look no further than the Spontaneous Remission Project, a database compiled by the Institute of Noetic Sciences of over 3,500 case studies in the medical literature of patients who have gotten better from seemingly incurable illnesses. You think there's such a thing as an incurable illness? I swear, if you go look at this database, it'll blow your mind. Everything's in there. Stage 4 cancers that disappeared without treatment. HIV-positive patients that became HIV-negative. Heart disease, kidney failure, diabetes, high blood pressure, thyroid disease, autoimmune diseases, gone. A great example of this in the medical literature is a case study from 1957 of Mr. Wright, who had advanced lymphosarcoma. So things weren't going well for Mr. Wright. Time was really running out. He had tumors the size of oranges in his armpits, his neck, his chest, his abdomen. His liver and his spleen were enlarged, and his lungs were filling up with 2 quarts of milky fluid every day that had to be drained in order for him to breathe. But Mr. Wright wasn't giving up hope. He had heard about this wonder drug called Prebiosin, and he was begging his doctor, come on, just give me some of that Prebiosin, it's all gonna be good. Now, unfortunately, the Prebiosin was only available on a research protocol, and the protocol required that the doctor be able to make an assessment that says that this guy has at least 3 months to live. And his doctor, Dr. West, just couldn't do that. But Mr. Wright was tenacious, and he didn't give up. He kept badgering his doctor. Until finally his doctor was like, okay, fine, I'll give you the Prebiosin. So he dosed him up on a Friday, not expecting that Mr. Wright would make it through the weekend. But to his utter shock, when Dr. West came in to do rounds on Monday, Mr. Wright was up walking around the wards, and his tumors had shrunk to half their original size. They had melted like snowballs on a hot stove, and 10 days after getting the Prebiosin, they were gone. So Mr. Wright was up rocking and rolling, like praising Prebiosin as the miracle drug he believed it to be, for 2 months, until the initial reports came out about Prebiosin that said that it didn't really look like Prebiosin was working so well. And Mr. Wright fell into a deep depression, and his cancer came back. So this time, Dr. West decided to get sneaky. He told his patient that, you know that Prebiosin that you got, that was a tainted version, really not so good. But I got us some ultra-pure, highly concentrated Prebiosin. This stuff's got it going on. He then injected Mr. Wright with nothing but distilled water. And once again, the tumors disappeared. The fluid in his lungs went away. Mr. Wright was up rocking and rolling for another 2 months. And then the American Medical Association blew it by publishing a nationwide study that proved definitively Prebiosin was worthless. 2 days later, Mr. Wright, after hearing this news, died. Soon after that, I came across another study in the medical literature that was the stuff of fairy tales. 3 baby girls were born, delivered by a midwife on Friday the 13th in the Okefenokee Swamp near the Georgia-Florida border. And the midwife pronounced that these 3 babies born on such a fateful day were all hexed. The first, she said, would die before her 16th birthday. The second, before her 21st. The third, before her 23rd birthday. And as it turned out, the first girl died the day before her 16th birthday. The second died the day before her 21st birthday. And the third girl, who knew what had happened to the other two, got wind of that. On the day before her 23rd birthday, she showed up at the hospital hyperventilating, begging them to make sure she survived. She wound up dying that night. These 2 case studies are great examples from the medical literature of the placebo effect and its opposite, the nocebo effect. So Mr. Wright, when he got that distilled water and his tumors melted away, that's a great example of the placebo effect. When you get a seemingly inert treatment, and yet something's happening physiologically in the body, such that the disease goes away. The nocebo effect is the opposite. So the 3 hexed girls are an example of the nocebo effect. When the mind's belief that something bad is going to happen in the body then comes to manifest.
Good. Thank you. We'll go back.
Scientific literature, yeah. That
we can take down the names, placebo and nocebo, PLACEBO and NOCEBO, and these are the 2 things. And even without getting any medication, one can get healed. At the same time, if the mind believes that you are already doomed, you can really get doomed. So that is the thing. Yeah. Next slide. So the need and relevance of silence today, as I already said. Next. Tension is a common word today. Burning both ears. You know, one fellow went to the doctor with ears burned. And the doctor said, how is it got burned? You know, when I was ironing this morning, the telephone rang by mistake. Instead of telephone, I put the iron box. But how is it the other ear also burned? Yeah, when I didn't get it here it properly, I put it here also. Okay. So silence is not silent. And we are afraid of it, so we avoid silence. But in silence only we really grow and come to know about ourselves. Yes. And in short, let us work for a spirituality that comes in our youth, not in our old age, I explained earlier. Spirituality that would keep us virtuous, and therefore we can be free from anxiety. When we are virtuous, there is no place for anxiety. Yeah. And spirituality that would keep us wise, and we are free from perplexity. When there is wisdom, there is no confusion, perplexity. Yes. And let us work for spirituality that would keep us brave, so that there is no room for fear. And spirituality that would keep us faithful, so that we may not lose meaning in life. Now, meaninglessness and faithlessness both go together. When there is faith, there is always meaning in life. And finally, my dear friends, what is it? The good thing of any bad thing? Please don't press the next slide, huh? Please wait. The good thing of any bad thing and the bad thing of any good thing. Can you think of it? If we say it correctly, for Iqbal will give you a prize. Any guess? The good thing of any bad thing, whatever thing, bad thing you think of it, the goodness of that bad thing, and the bad thing of any good thing. Do I like sound like a philosopher? Yes. Pardon?
It will end.
Good. Correct. Exactly. Yeah. Next slide. Both have to come to an end. That's the good thing of a bad thing and the bad thing of a good thing. I think he deserves a good applause. Okay? For example, if you think that my talk presentation has been good, the bad thing about that good thing is it has to come to an end. Or the other way, if you think that my presentation has been very bad, the good thing about that presentation is that it comes to an end. How practical we are? Yes. And therefore, finally, stop stressing, start living. Thank you very much.